Right, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Bob Phillips, and I'm a professor here at Columbia and head of the Center for Pricing and Revenue Management. And this is the last in our speaker series for this academic year. I think we've probably saved the best for last. I don't know, that's sort of up to you. And I'm very pleased to introduce David Hornik, managing partner, is that your title? Something like that at August Capital. David is a very diverse individual. He has training in computer music, and he was also a lawyer. So kind of two hands there before becoming a venture capitalist. And he also has great interest in musical theater. He's promised Hamilton tickets to anyone who stays to the end.
I tried to produce Hamilton. I reached out to them. I produced Avenue Q. And I say produce, I mean I gave them like $7. But so I reached out to the Hamilton folks after seeing it at the public, like, oh my God, I have to invest in this company. And they were like, we're fine. We're fine, we don't need you. So sadly, no.
So, and in August Capital, he's invested in lots of different companies. He's invested in a company I founded called Noma Solutions. He's invested in Splunk. He'll tell you more about some of the companies that he has invested in. August is well known because, among other things, I think you're the only VC to invest in Microsoft. Is that correct?
Only private investors in Microsoft.
So
that's pretty good.
That one went
through. Do that again. For them.
That allowed you to invest in Nomus, I guess.
Yeah.
But, also, you've taught intellectual property law at both Stanford and Harvard, right?
Yes, I have.
So without any further ado, please welcome David Hornik.
All right. Well, thank you. So pricing. Where should we start with? We could start with you. We could focus on Nomus. We could start with the venture business. I went to college. I studied computer music. That qualifies you to do nothing. I then got an MPhil in criminology. Nothing. Then I went and got a law degree. And that qualified me to be a lawyer. So that was so I did that for a while. And in 2000, in June of 2000, the partners at August Capital, who had gotten to know me because I was representing a this is so echoey. I was the lawyer to a company called Evite. Have you all received an Evite at some point or other? They got to know me because I was on that board, I was the lawyer to that company, yet I sat around these board meetings thinking that it was my job to pontificate about the business. It turns out that wasn't my job. My job was to just point out illegal things. But that seemed boring compared to the job of a venture capitalist, which is to say, hey, you should talk to this person, you should do this thing, or you should do whatever. And so after doing that a fair amount, my now partners at this firm, August Capital, were like, hey, have you ever thought about the venture business? To which I said, yes, I love the venture business. I then became a venture capitalist and I learned that I knew nothing about the venture business. I love the idea of the venture business, but I didn't know exactly what it entailed. What is it to be a venture capitalist? The full training for me to be a VC when I arrived at August Capital. Well, first of all, I arrived in my office and I see my first new partner. He says, oh, are you here today? And I said, yes, this is my first day. And they said, fantastic. Here is your office. We have our partner meeting at noon. And that was the entirety of my training in the venture business. So that qualified me to invest in Nomus, among other companies. And what I realized was, okay, if this is the job, which is to find interesting startups, then what does that entail? What is it that one actually does in the venture business to find interesting startups? So job number one, actually, is to meet interesting and amazing people, right? The path to amazing startups is through amazing people. That has always been the case. That will always be the case. And so step one was, okay, I'm going to spend a lot of time meeting with lots of amazing people, getting to know them, building a set of relationships. And in fact, the way I met Nomus was through a string of relationships, which is interesting. That first relationship was my partner, John, who was the first investor in Intuit. And so he was involved in Intuit from the early days. And a young guy who was building a company at Intuit who left Intuit to build a company, reached out to John and said, I'm starting a company and it's taking payroll online. And John said, wow, is that boring. David, you should take a look at this. So I sat down with that company. This entrepreneur was a guy named Rene Lassert. And Rene explained to me why it was that, this is now 15 years ago, why it was that it would make a bunch of sense to have a hosted payroll service that was in the cloud, although it wasn't yet called the cloud, and that this made a bunch of sense. And I ultimately decided that that was a good idea, and we invested in this company, only to later determine that, only later learn that I was the 50th venture capitalist that Rene had pitched. The 49 prior to me said no, but that's all right. I funded Rene, I funded this company, and that helped me then get to know the Intuit mafia. And we ultimately sold that company to Intuit because it was obvious, and that was a great outcome. But that same entrepreneur now has a company called Bill.com, which is about accounts payable and accounts receivable, and he's really branching out from payroll. But through that, through the Intuit folks, I met another investor who was the first to commit to investing in Nomus, and he introduced me then to the company. So people matter, they matter a lot, but it turns out that there's a certain amount I'm reluctant to call it expertise, but I guess there's no other descriptor, which is there's a certain amount of expertise that builds up in you, like an immunity, when you're in the venture business. And the reason that that's the case is that my job, I've been at August now for 16 years. So for the last 16 years, my year has gone something like this. I sit down at my desk, I get lots and lots of email and introductions, and over the course of a year, I probably get 1,000 executive summaries of some sort or other from entrepreneurs being introduced by others, reaching out to me, et cetera. And of those, and I read those 1,000. So step one is read 1,000 executive summaries. I'm dyslexic, so I'm grateful they're short. If they're not short, that's bad news. It's hard for me to get to page 2. Of those 1,000 executive summaries that I read, I find 100 of them compelling. Now, there are all sorts of reasons why you might find 100 of them compelling. They may be the people who introduced them, or the idea, the opportunity. But of those 1,000, I respond to 100 of them with the following email. Hey, please meet my assistant Mary. Let's get together for an hour and talk about what you're doing. Okay, so then those 100 I sit down with for an hour. So I spend 100 hours learning about these different companies in any given year. Those 100 hours could range from price optimization to analytics companies, to companies that are doing advertising, to consumer web products, to infrastructure products. They're a broad range of things. And of those 100, I probably think 10 of them are kind of interesting. I spend another, call it 10 hours on each of those 10. So now I'm up to a couple hundred hours that I've spent looking at technology broadly. And of those 10, probably invest in 2. Maybe 1. So in any given year, I've touched 1,000 companies, 1,000 different businesses. I've gotten focused on 100, then 10, then 1. I've probably spent about 250 hours on diligence, the process of figuring out if they're interesting. And then that 250 hours is replicated across the last 16 years that I've been at this, which is a pretty good postdoc in stuff, which is, yes. Yeah, it turns out that I've been pretty lucky in that regard. One of the interesting things about the venture business right now is that it is quite competitive. There is a small subset of the venture investors that get to see things early and then get to compete for those particular deals, and then so we're sort of fighting with each other. And it turns out that the Rene Lassert pay cycle thing was a rarity. It is rare that 50 people see a deal and only one of them thinks it's interesting, and then it actually turns out to be a couple hundred million dollar outcome, right? That's not the norm. The norm is that a couple or 5 people go, huh, that's interesting, please let me fund you, right? I recently had one of these where there were six of us who had given this company a term sheet, and then it became this brawl of, you know, like, take my money, no, take my money, no, take my money. I had one instance where I had a similar circumstance. The entrepreneur had several term sheets, and I spent a lot of time saying, you know, talk to these people, talk to these people, you'll find out about what it's like to work with me, et cetera. And I knew that on this particular day, he was going to decide whose money he was going to take. And I also knew that it was no longer down to terms or anything else. It was just this particular entrepreneur was going to decide. And so I was driving home, and I was feeling quite helpless, because that's, like, think about that. That's a horrible thing. You spend a year and 1,000 companies, you get down to one of the two you want to fund, and then you're just waiting to hear, like, oh, what about me? So I called him up, and he picked up the phone, and I said, hey, Max, how are you? And he said, good. Hey, David, what's happening? I said, look, I know that you're making this decision today, and I know that you've gathered a lot of data, and I just wanted to let you know how much I love you. That was to which he said, David, you could not have made that clearer. And I said, awesome, I'll catch you later. And I hung up the phone. It was like, there was no upside to that call. There was, in fact, no upside to making that call, but there certainly was no upside beyond that. I ended up funding that company, so that worked out well. Apparently, it was not unrequited love. That was nice. So here's my universe, right? Which is, so I've been very lucky, and I'd say over the 16 years, I've had a handful of companies that I wanted to fund and I didn't. And like I said, that is unusually good. Now, I should point out that I've also had an astonishing number of amazing companies that I should have offered money to that I did not. And I like to say that the venture business is all about regret. And that is certainly true if one were to look at, you know, things like, you know, the Series A of Palantir, or the Series B of LinkedIn, or the Series A of Twitter, or the Series A of Uber, or whatever, all of which I said no to. For lots of really good reasons, I can assure you and my investors. but luckily, we've said, you know, August, as a firm, there are five partners. We've been at it for a bunch of time. And we were the earliest investors in Microsoft and Sun, Compaq, Intuit, Symantec, et cetera. So it's gone perfectly well. But the ones, you never remember those. That's not what you do. You spend all your time weeping about the stupid choices you made. All right, so back to analytics, because that's, you know, what we're here for. Although I'm happy to talk about me. So I've spent, let's call it 15 years looking at companies, and I've been watching the evolution of companies, and what's interesting to me, and this I think is good news for this room, is that in 15 years ago, when people came and pitched an analytics business, they pitched, you know, we're gonna take a bunch of data, we're gonna put it in a cube, and we're gonna sort through it, and we're gonna create value, and those people were very nerdy, and their companies got no respect. And even if they end up being wildly successful, you know, you've had good successes. You've changed the nature of how air travel and all these things. But these were not the cool kids by any stretch of the imagination 15 years ago. Well, guess what? That has changed. How has that changed? It has changed because it is no longer a world of analytics. It is the world of big data. And analytics is super nerdy and uncompelling. And big data is super sexy, and everybody wants some of that. And so I like to joke that the actuaries, who used to be the most maligned, you know, employees on the planet, although apparently the happiest, I don't know if you knew that, but being an actuary was the best job according to job happiness. But you still couldn't really go home and feel, you know, couldn't, like, go to a bar and be like, I'm an actuary, yo. That didn't do much for you. But actuaries are now data scientists, and data scientists can do exactly that, right? In Silicon Valley, if you're at a bar and someone goes, hey, what do you do? You go, I'm a data scientist. People go, whoa, that's awesome. And there's a reason for that, and the reason for that is that data science has created an immense amount of value, right? That what has happened, the shift from when I started in the venture world, where, you know, anyone who was smart and thoughtful was thinking about how they could use data, to today, where no one can create a business without understanding the underlying data. If you were to pitch me today on a business without explaining the ways in which you're going to use the underlying data of that business, then you will not get funded, right? That is indeed, as we were talking earlier, table stakes. This is what it takes to build an amazing business. And so I guess the question is sort of is what has caused that shift and how can you take advantage of it, right? Because this is, here's your chance. Here's the world you live in. This is stuff that's of interest to you and how you can create value. So how many people have heard of this company Splunk that I funded? Has anyone heard of it? All right, that's exciting. There are a few Splunkers. I've been on the Splunk board for, I think, 13 years. So 13-ish years ago, 12 or 13 years ago, I had these three entrepreneurs come into my office, and they said, there's more and more machine data. That's not quite how they described it. At the time, they just said, there are lots of log files, and there are more and more log files. And so when systems break, we can't get to the answer quickly. What do? You do what's called grepping files, which also is known as reading them. And so you read through these log files, searching for the needle in the haystack, and eventually you go, oh, wait a second, there's a router error. That's the problem. And then you go sort out what was broken. And these particular entrepreneurs said, wouldn't it be better if, like everything today, you had a search that sat on top of it, and we could search for the problem by saying, hey, show me, you know, oh, this particular server had a failure. Show me every instance of a call to that server or whatever. And that was the pitch. That was the pitch to me. It was like, wouldn't that be better? And I said, wow, that would be better, you know. And we had a set of conversations that mostly involved me saying, so could you do that? And they said, yeah, we can do it. And I took them at their word, and I gave them their first $4 million and said, great, let's go build that thing. And they did exactly that. It took them 2.5 years, but they built this search engine for machine data that's called Splunk. It was originally called Applicity and then Transaction Engines and then Splunk. I think that's an excellent evolution. And basically what it did is it is a gigantic unstructured database of log files that sucks in log files and creates time series data across those log files. So the only thing you need to know is what the file says and when it happened. And then you can use a search engine that sits on top of it to figure out what is going on in your enterprise. And the very first customers were IT people who were trying to do system debugging. And the Splunk has this, their first T-shirt was taking the SH out of IT. It became a much appreciated T-shirt. And these IT people would then search through log files, basically figure out what's broken. But what they quickly discovered is, actually, this mechanism, this infrastructure allowed you to do anything, right? It was, okay, if I'm trying to understand traffic that comes into my site, I can search that and understand the interactions. If I'm trying to figure out optimizations, what happens if I do A or B, I can do that with this. Because in the end, everything that happens in these in the machines that are creating the value, whatever your company, it's just machine data. And it's easy to suck into an index, and then it's easy to then search across. And so now Splunk is being used for system debugging, for security, for compliance, for all of these things. It is a big company. And when the company went public, everybody said, "Oh my God, this is it—the poster child for big data. We've got this outcome." And look, in the venture business, it turns out there's this ridiculous thing where when something works, then everybody, "Oh, I got to do that." Like, "Oh, big data worked. This company went public. It was trading at billions of dollars." Like, "Oh, big data's hot. We got to fund big data." The only problem is big data was a thing that came into existence with the likes of Hadoop and Splunk and other enterprise instances that were gathering infinite amounts of data and allowing you to manipulate them. It was too late to do the infrastructure piece, right? If you had funded Hortonworks, if you had funded some other Hadoop, you know, instance, or you'd funded Splunk, then you got to claim that platform for data. But once that had happened, then it was over. It was too late. Now, the good news about having invested early is that I got to reap the benefits of them having gotten there ahead of the curve. The bad news is then I got every pitch on the planet about how someone was going to do the next thing, only it was done, right? And I had to say that in most instances, I'd say, you could do that with Splunk. Oh, well, you could do that with Hadoop. Oh, you could do that with Splunk, right? But the good news is that once that infrastructure was in place, then it changed the nature of every single website on the planet, every single web service, every single piece of infrastructure suddenly allowed you with a relatively simple process to make those things data aware, right? And you can call it analytics, and or you could call it big data, or you could call it machine data, but in the end, the shift that I witnessed from the beginning of my venture career to now is that everything now has this underpinning of analytics. Everything has this underpinning of how are we going to use machine data to create value for the things that we are doing, right? And that's amazing, and it's created a massive amount of opportunity, and it's created a massive amount of value. So let me just give a few examples of that. So Nomus is a good example of it. Nomus came into the world, I don't know how much you've heard the tale, but you know, ultimately the pitch that I received from the good doctor was, why in the world is it that the entire banking universe has spent all of its time trying to figure out risk and worry about risk, which is an important data problem, but has not then worried about profit, right? Those two things could be decoupled, and if you were to take an immense amount of data, in particular segmentation data, then you could figure out that there are some people like me who are stupid and will pay an unreasonable price, and then there's some people like Bob who are not and will pay only the margin that is appropriate given the competition. And therefore, I am your best customer, and you should do whatever it takes to get me, and then you should bilk me for all I am worth, and you should avoid him, perhaps, because, you know, not so valuable. Now, when pitched on this idea, it struck me that that was a good one. Like, that makes good sense. And so once again, you're left with this question, which is, has it been done, or is it being done by others? The answer in this instance was no. In fact, all of these financial institutions had their own organizations that were dealing with risk. Very few of them were thinking about profitability. There were fewer of them were thinking about maximizing the value of any given customer. And can you do it? Like, is that even a possibility, right? And so that was the conversation I had. And then I actually also had another conversation, which is, if you could do this for banks and money, couldn't you do this for insurance and insurance carriers? Because same thing, right? Insurance has shifted dramatically over the course of the 15 years that I've been in the venture business. And here's how. Insurance is, again, an actuarial task, right? Which is, you say, okay, I want to insure you from driving this vehicle, and how much money is it likely to cost me? And so you aggregate a huge amount of data. You take a bunch of demographic data, a bunch of broad data, and then you say, okay, you as a class of people will be this likely to, and all they really care about is run someone over and cost us millions of dollars. Not so much like crash your Mercedes, although they're vaguely interested in that. And so they go through this process, and as a result, I have four teenagers at the moment. So I will pay an infinite amount of money for my insurance. That is the byproduct. The byproduct is David pays an infinite amount of money for his insurance, undifferentiating in some regards among my children. But in particular, what's unbelievable is that I have two teenage sons who are driving. And if you knew anything about these two sons, you would know that one of those sons is of low risk for running someone down in most circumstances. except for his relative incompetence at driving, he's not doing the other things that dramatically increase the risk of running someone down. My other son, not so much. Yet both of them, because they get good grades, is an indicator that they therefore must get better insurance rates than the average stupid teenage boy, but still pay an infinite amount of money compared to me. Now that may or may not be fair, but I'll tell you that not differentiating between the two of them is moronic. And the only reason that exists is because no one had the data to distinguish between the two, right? If you could follow them, then you would say, oh, okay, these are different people. We all know everybody's different, but the best we can do, and this is what we've done at Nomis, and this is what others have done in other contexts, is say, what are the categories that are the greatest indicators of behavior, and how can we distinguish among those, and how many of those are legal? It turns out that some of them are not legal, even if it turns out that it's a stunningly good indicator of what a good or bad driver I am, being a 5'4" Jew, maybe 5'4", totally good Jew, maybe not so much. So here we have data, we're slicing it and dicing it as best we can, and that creates a ton of value, and it did create a ton of value for banks. Nomis has now optimized $1 trillion, is that right?
1.8.
$1.8 trillion it has optimized and extracted many, many hundreds of millions of dollars in greater profits by virtue of doing that, by virtue of saying, boy, David, that rate for you is 1.8. You know, me going, no, I'm too lazy. But here's what's happening that's even better. Now in the insurance world, I've been pitched on multiple companies that are saying, why in the world would you not have personalized insurance? If we could provide the insurance carriers with precise data on your behavior, would you not then be able to create a better actuarial model to determine how expensive this individual is, right? Wouldn't it be better then to be able to say of my two children, this one is behaving this way, never has a jackrabbit start, never is out past 2 in the morning, never screeches his brakes, never plays the radio extraordinarily loudly, never picks up his phone while he is driving. This dude is your man. The other one does all of those things, I know with great certainty. And if you were to have that data, then you could price the insurance with much greater granularity. And all of the insurance carriers at the moment are trying to figure out how to do just that. And there are a bunch of startups that are doing this just that. They've created, you know, apps that they say, okay, here's the deal. You run the app, we know what you're doing, we know how you're behaving, and then we'll price your insurance accordingly. So what's the problem with that? Well, privacy won, although frankly, you give it a, you know, you give them the right. Yeah, it's just, it's like super healthy people going, yeah, let's all get together in the same insurance pool. We're all good, you know, and then all the sick people go, oh man. And so all the sick people get this terribly inflated rate, and all the poor people, all the healthy people, you know, are scot-free. So it's a tricky insurance problem, which says, okay, if people are self-determining, then yeah, you'll have better insurance numbers, but it will cause an incredible tip to the insurance pool. So one thing that I will say that has been so interesting to me about becoming data aware, about taking this data and being able to finally understand it, is that you then can truly understand that no action has, that every single action has some meaningful repercussions down the line in some way or other. And the startups that get that wrong get it wrong in a big way. The startups that get it right understand that they have no idea. And therefore, they don't make big bets based on the downwards, you know, downward pressure of a particular business. So for example, I have a company that that is an e-commerce company, right? And they sell a lot of stuff. They create these communities of people that share interests, and then those communities of people are buying things in kind of group sales. So you say like, oh, if we sell 100 of these headphones, then it'll be this price. We sell 200, it'll be this lower price. And so we have a very clear understanding over time of what it takes to convince people to buy 100 headphones and what the pricing is and what impact pricing will have on the likelihood that you sell 100 or then you sell 200, right? And the reason that we have a very clear view of this is because it turns out you can test it. The beauty of the internet, the beauty of technology today is that there are massive numbers of people doing all of these things that allow us to then test. I don't know if you saw, but there was a little bit of a brouhaha around Facebook last week where it was implied that Facebook had sufficient data about their users that they could impact elections. That they could do a set of things to impact the way that people's the things that people saw and therefore the things that they were driven by and therefore could in fact impact elections. How do we know this? Because they've done all sorts of things around everything else, and they control they have an infinite amount of data about 2 billion people, and they know how often you show up, and they determine what they put in front of you, right? So if you're Facebook, You have this unbelievable competitive advantage because you have an infinite amount of data. If you're Google, you have an unbelievable competitive advantage because you have an infinite amount of data, right? That data becomes an incredible differentiator, incredibly valuable. So my company is out aggregating hundreds of thousands of people to sell them a set of things. And so the conversation we had at the board meeting was, what if, because we have this product that people love, after we do this kind of group sale thing where you sell 100 and then you sell 200, we then just put it in a store. And at a higher price, you just sell it. That's a reasonable question, right? Maybe you'd, instead of selling 200, you'd sell 500 over some period of time. So the question then that I asked was, what impact does putting it in the store have on the likelihood that you sell the first 100 and you sell the second 100, right? What is the impact? Is it that price break that's dropping it? Or is it the fact that it's time limited? Or is it the fact that it is limited in total number that are gonna be sold? Like, what are the factors that are determining the ways in which people are buying these products? Now the good news is, to a certain degree, they can test this, they can figure it out, right? Take two related products, run one, with a sale of the thing in the end, run another where you don't do it, then rerun the sale again and see if there's a differentiator, right? Do you sell more in the instance where there isn't a product that's for sale forever? Or do you sell more by just simply letting it run forever, right? But for every one of these actions, there are unbelievable implications across the next set of things. Like, does that then impact the likelihood that someone buys the next set of headphones, et cetera? And one of the things that's so tricky, and this is a problem that if any of you can figure out how to solve today for the future, then I will fund you and you will be rich. So here is the problem, LTV. Lifetime value. Every single company that I have invested in that is trying to acquire customers in some way or other has to measure the cost of acquiring those customers versus the lifetime value of those customers, right? And the best that we can do is make it up. And this is why. Most companies that create value, some real value, have a lifetime value curve that goes something like this. Someone bought, your customers, all start up by customers by buying something, right? So they start, here they are. Oh, this is exciting, Bob. I'm writing on the board. It's like science. So you start here. This is 100%. This is 0%. So 100% of your customers, because they're customers, buy something in the first instance. And then they do this. And then they do that. And now, here are the questions that you need to ask yourselves to figure out lifetime value, which is, how much margin are you making on whatever it is you're selling at the first instance? And then what is this number? Is this, you know, 10% or is it 20% or is it 40%? It's never 40%, it's more like 2%, right? And then more importantly, does it in fact go forever, right? And if you could if you knew this, if you could predict with great certainty what the answer to these things was, how much money will someone spend on my experience, whether that's through advertising, in-game app purchases, whatever, what then you could say, okay, great. In the first instance, my customer is worth $3 to me, and then this piece is worth another $6, and then this infinite amount is worth somewhere between, you know, $20 and $24. Now I look at it, okay, great. Guess what? It's $29 is how much I'm going to make on my customer over some number of years. More importantly, it's $9 that I'm going to make on my customers in this period of time, which let's call it 2 years. If you knew this, then you could say, oh, acquisition's easy. I would like to acquire customers for less than $3 because then they're instantaneously profitable. But in the event that I can't do that, I'd like to acquire them for something shy of $9 because then it's worthwhile, right? I will ultimately make something like $30 off of this customer. So being able to acquire them for $9 is pretty good. The only problem is it takes a while to earn that back. So I need to raise a ton of money to do this. So if you can understand this curve, then you can understand how you want to go acquire customers, and then you can do that kind of experimentation. The only problem is that you have no idea, right? You don't know. If this is a six-year phenomena, then it will take you 6 years before you know what the lifetime value, what the first 6 years of lifetime value are. And the rest is just speculation. This is a hugely hard and interesting problem, and it turns out that it determines the value of everything I've invested in, right? Everything I've invested in. Payroll, how much does it cost to get a payroll customer, and how much are they worth over time, and how good is the product, and how long will they stay with it? Turns out that in payroll, one of the primary reasons that people stopped paying for PayCycle is that they went out of business. So, yeah, they'll use payroll for as long as you've got it. And the only problem is that most businesses are going out of business. Most small businesses are running out of business. And so they stop paying people. They just pay themselves. They used to have an employee, and now I don't have an employee. So suddenly lifetime value is cut in half, not because the product sucks, but because you do. No offense. So anyway, it is a super interesting question, and every single thing that you do in these companies has immediate repercussions as to the lifetime value of the company. I had an investment in a company called Ebates. Has anyone ever used Ebates? All right, there are a few of you, that's exciting. Ebates is an online shopping mall where when you go and buy something, you go to Ebates and say, I want to buy a thing. They say, well, buy it through this store and you'll get 3% back. Buy it through this store and you get 4% back. And then you click through, and Ebates will get a referral fee for your shopping, and they'll keep some of it, and they'll give some of it to you, right? Pretty simple idea. And so they got going in the early days, and they acquired a bunch of customers, and those customers were busy spending on the site, and they were getting value, and life was good. And so here's the customer growth numbers, right? They grew very quickly at first, and then as the internet collapsed in the early 2000s, they sort of slowed down acquisition, and they went like this for a period of time. And so, you know, it grew a little bit, but now you look at this business and you go, uh-oh, this business is in trouble. And in many ways it was, because it was flatlined and you want more customers, whatever. But here was the interesting thing. In year one, if you spent $1 on the site, in year five, you spent $1.20. So customers you'd acquired 5 years earlier were more active on average than than they were when they began, and it turned out in year 10, they were still spending $1.20, or whatever the number was. It was something spectacular. It turned out that the lifetime value of these customers was like infinite. But you wouldn't know that in year 1. You got a hint of it in year 5, but when these numbers are holding up, these cohorts are holding up in year 10, and the new cohorts are doing exactly the same thing, now you look and go, oh my God, these customers are gold. Brought in a CEO who looked at this and said, okay, we're going to create value for the stores. We're going to convince them that the real value is in getting people on the site and spending money through Ebates, and that we're a great acquisition channel. And suddenly companies started spending money to bring people into their stores by increasing the money back, right? So suddenly you'd get 4% cash back instead of 2, or 8% cash back instead of 4. That turned out to be incredibly important because suddenly not only did more people come, they're like, oh, 4% back, you know? It's like a 4% off sale. Turns out that actually motivated people. 4% off sale! Suddenly the numbers went like this. It ended up being this great cycle where you'd make more money because more people would shop, which made your stores happier, which made them do it more often, which made more people shop. And so now you go from this same phenomena, which is $1.20 to the first dollar spent over an infinite period of time, times an infinite number of customers. And the end product of that is that we, in year 14, long time, but in year 14, the company was sold to a company called Rakuten for $1 billion. Unbelievable. In year 10, could have sold for $100 million, right? By year 10, by year 14, understood the lifetime value, understood the data that drove behavior, understood the value it created, and we're able to then turn that into more customers, happier customers, greater value for our stores, greater value for us as a company, and now greater value for Rakuten, and very happy limited partners in August Capital. That's a win. That's a good one. So any questions? I'm happy to continue on, but before I do, anything? Yeah. Yeah, this is the problem, right? Which is, so here's the far end of this problem, which is, people say, okay, David, you've been in the venture business for 16 years, so you must see patterns and be able to do a better job, right? So maybe I said no to Palantir 12 years ago or whatever, but I shouldn't have said no to Uber because now I'm smart, right? So here's the problem with that. If you consider the data points in venture, right? The average company takes, to be successful these days, takes 6 or 8 years to demonstrate success. To be a failure, it's maybe a couple years. But for the success case, which is what you're trying to understand and fix for, it's a, let's call it, 6-year cycle, right? Which means year one, I make two investments, right? 6 years later, I get a data point about those two investments, some certainty around which of those investments are looking successful. And I often liken it to going to the eye doctor every 6 years, right? Okay, which one's better, this or this? You go, oh, it's this. They go, all right, come back in 6 years. You'll have two more data points, and then we'll determine, you know, what's the path to building that great company. It's an insufficient number of data points to get any meaningful data. And more importantly, over the 6-year period of time between data points, my eyes have changed, right? The environment changes completely. If you were building a company in 2000, you didn't understand the power of social media. You didn't understand the power of connecting people as an underlying platform to a consumer experience. If you're building that same company in 2008 and you do not build in social, if you don't make it that you push it to Facebook and connect with your friends or whatever, you will fail with 100% certainty. And so that shift in, so you have too few data points and you have this shifting environment. Now think about what you're describing, which is lots and lots of data points over time, but again, a shifting environment and what is the relevant time point. You're right, once you get to a model that says that this is 13% and then it goes forever, then you can rely on that model. You just better keep track of it, because the day it stops working is the day your company goes out of business, right? And so you are constantly in this battle of, I have a model that I believe to work, I'm going to make choices based on that model, but good entrepreneurs are also saying, but I better second guess it every second, because if it shifts and it turns out that this initial purchase goes to a buck and I'm spending five, then we run out of money in 3 months, right? I've seen this across, the better your company is doing, the bigger it's getting, right? I have two e-commerce companies that are a good example of this. One is this little company called Top Hatter that has an app, and it allows you to to buy things online in real-time auctions. So you look at it and it's like, oh, here's a ring for sale right now, or here's a pair of jeans or a purse or whatever, and there's bidding. It's at $23, $24, and you can bid on it until it sells, and then it sells, and the next thing comes up. And so first they built the app, then they got some stuff on the app, then they started tracking how well it was doing, then you could track how valuable those consumers were. You could build a model of lifetime value, and then you start doing, so you have dual track. You have how valuable is a customer and how valuable can I make them over time, and then you have what does it cost me to acquire a customer and how much lower can I make that over time. So those two things are marching along, and at some point they cross, and Top Hatter says, okay, great. I was spending $100,000 a month on Facebook. Now I'll spend $500,000 a month. And in that month, are they diverging? Are they reconverging? What's happening? So this year, that number will be millions of dollars that they spend on Facebook. But if you're spending millions of dollars to acquire customers and something shifts in those curves, you could lose an immense amount of money in a very short period of time, right? Here's another interesting one that is about data and the value of data. We invested in a company called Zulily. Zulily was this group buying company for moms and for grandmas, basically. And they sold lots and lots and lots of little shirts and shoes. It was adorable. And when I say a lot, like, oh, we're going to sell baby Crocs today, and we'll sell $6 million worth of baby Crocs or whatever. So they aggregated up this set of buyers through a range of channels, acquired consumers into the platform, and they had a mailing list in the millions, right? So in any given day, you'd wake up in the morning and you'd get this thing. Here are the things that are on sale at Zulily, and if you're a Zulily consumer, you'd open that email in all likelihood, and you'd go, ooh, that's a cute onesie, and you'd buy it or not. Like, that was the experience. So here's what Zulily did. They said, if we have millions of people, and we know that the different things you do on this email impact the click-through rate, we should test that before we go sending it out. And because they had so many users, first thing in the morning with their first cohort that woke up, they would send out 10 different versions. Here are 10 different versions. And over the next half hour, they would measure the impact of those different versions on their first set of cohorts. And they basically used that as A/B testing for the email of the day. Then they still had millions of people who they could then send the optimized email to, right? And that had a monumental impact. It increased click-throughs immensely. And more importantly, they figured out, oh, actually, we don't really care about click-through, right? What we care about is click-to-sale. So they stopped tracking click-through. They started tracking which of these emails sells the most crap. oh, it turns out this one with the cute model and the little dress, and it says buy now, and it says this. And that one they then sent to 10 million people, and they sold hundreds of millions of dollars worth of little kid stuff, went public, traded up to $10 billion. It was a great outcome. Why was it a great outcome? Because the founder of that company, or the founders of that company, came out of the company Blue Nile. Blue Nile, selling diamonds, right? Incredible commodity, immense price pressure, not a lot of margin. Everything they did in Blue Nile mattered. The cost of acquisition, the channels of acquisition, the value of a sale, the possibility of a future sale, all of that stuff was immensely important to them to make Blue Nile work. They took all of that learning and they applied it to baby clothing. And it was just the most data aware company I have seen in forever. And as a result, their Fab and Gilt and all these companies that looked like they were going to be amazing have basically gone out of business or sold at a huge loss to their investors. And Zulily actually made its investors a ton of money. So God bless the data scientists. I'm deeply in debt to the data scientists who made that work. Yeah. I know nothing about anything. So I'm just as good a data scientist as I am a financial engineer. It's perfect. This is totally fair. Like, this is my whole point about my life for the last, decade and a half has been about amazing people like you coming and sitting down in front of me and saying, here is how we think about this problem. Here is what we apply to this problem, right? So I sit down with the Splunk team. They describe the search engine for machine data. I say, okay, that sounds good. I give them $4 million. A buddy of mine, Nick Sturiali, gives him another $4 million. Nick and I sit down at the board meeting and say, how's it going? And they describe what they're doing. And so over the course of the last 12 or 13 years, I have gotten a tutorial on Splunk. Here's what's happening. Here's what's happening in the Hadoop world. Here's what's happening in Elasticsearch. Here's why Elastic is... Then I see another company, this super interesting hosted search company that's basically building a hosted Elasticsearch for e-commerce. And I go, okay, well, what do I know about this? 10 years ago, nothing. 12 years later, okay, I kind of get it. I understand that here are the alternatives. Here's how one might work. Here's why implementing your own Elasticsearch may make sense. Here's why building an Elastic in the cloud may create value. Here's the challenges of that. But more importantly, here's the next step. Hey, Bob, take a look. Do me a favor. I'm looking at this thing. It seems kind of interesting. Would you mind spending an hour with them telling me what you think? Because VCs don't know anything. They don't. It's not our job to know anything. It's our job to know amazing people who hopefully know something. Like I always say, if I know more than you do about your business, one of us is an idiot. Like, that's just very simple. Because if I actually know more than you about your business, then you're a moron. Because this is what you do. Like, this, you live this thing. I can't possibly know more than you. But more to the point, if I in fact know more than you about something amazing, I should go start that company. That's a way better bet, right? All of my friends who built incredible companies, they have more fun, they've created more value, they have family foundations, they go on better vacations, their children are better looking. Like, there are all sorts of reasons that I should start that company on my own if I actually were smarter than the entrepreneurs. The good news for me is I'm never smarter. So it's fine. There's no pressure on me to actually do anything. I get to continue doing what VCs do, which is this. Someone gives me a lot of money, and I hand it to you. That's what I do. And if all goes well, I take back more than I started with, and I give it back to Yale, and everybody's happy. Yep.
But what else do we need to do, or how do we gain that decision making skill? Because we don't have to learn the application.
Yes. This is sort of a shared answer to both of these questions, which, as it turns out, it's hard math, but it's not a hard decision process, right? It turns out, and one of the reasons that being a lawyer, I think, has been vaguely valuable to being a venture capitalist is that the only thing they actually teach you in law school is how to be logical. It's like how to go from A to B to C and come to some outcome. And that is all you do at all when you're building a company, is make a set of assumptions, test those assumptions, make a set of reasonable assumptions, do things that make good sense reasonably to test those assumptions, and then adjust your assumptions according to the data you receive. That is company building. Now it turns out that the number of assumptions is massive and the amount of data is infinite and all these things that make it slightly harder than that description. But I remember talking with one entrepreneur very early on in his career and early on in my career, and he said to me, David, I'm at a loss as to how to run this company. There are all these choices and what am I supposed to do? I said, oh, this is easy, it's a piece of cake. I said, sit down and in front of a piece of paper and write down your top 100 priorities in rank order of what you think needs to get done in this company. Got them? Do numbers 1 through 3. And by the way, while you're doing 1 through 3, if number 4 becomes more important than 1 through 3, do it. That's it. And he was like, that's so useless. But it's true, right? It's totally true. That's what you do. I was being interviewed once I was giving a talk before a bunch of executives in a big bank. And I was asked this question, which is, David, does it frustrate you that you never have all of the data necessary to make a decision, right? You're constantly making decisions based on a limited amount of information and not the whole amount of information. And my answer to that person was, here's the good news. Because I'm dyslexic, I never have all the information, not even in a sentence. I never have all the information, so I'm good at that. That's what I do, which is take what data I have and figure out what I think the outcome is. That's what you have to be able to do. If you think you're gonna get all the data and you're gonna get to the outcome and you're gonna get an answer, it'll kill you because you never will be done. So all you can do is make reasonable assumptions, collect and measure that data as best you can, and adjust those assumptions accordingly. One sec, yeah.
Because, like you said, the world's so big, you can't know everything, and it's changing so quickly. What characteristics do you use to invest in the people? It's like, when you look at people walking the door, there's things that either say this is a very good sign, this is a very bad sign, that have proven relatively true over the last decade now.
Yeah, this is hugely important. Like, this is my entire job. So I can't tell you, or I'd have to kill you. Part of what it takes to be an amazing entrepreneur is that you have to be a great salesperson. Now, that's not actually a great answer because there are lots of different ways to sell, right? There are some people who are very salesy and big and whatever. There are other people who sell with data, whatever. But your job as an entrepreneur is to convince people to do irrational things, right? It's to convince me to give you money even though you're probably gonna lose it. It's to convince people to give up a really good job to join you even though you'll likely go out of business. It's to convince a big customer to use your software even though it's completely unproven, right? So step one is you have to be able to convince me that you're good at selling, that you can sell the proposition that you're putting before me. Now what does that mean? That means that ultimately you have to appear to genuinely believe that this is the best possible thing you could be doing with your time, right? That this is so important, so exciting, so valuable, and so aligned with you as a human that this is what you must do, right? That's step one. Step two is you have to give me the impression, ideally, and it has to, and ideally it would be true, that you are the world's leading expert on this thing that you think you can solve. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to have invented price optimization, although that helped in our meeting. It was like, oh, you fucked up air travel. You might as well fuck up loans. That sounds good, you know. But it doesn't have to be that. It has to be like, okay, I have taken the time to become to gather all the information that there is to gather on this particular thing, and I can speak thoughtfully about it. Now, this includes a very important caveat, which is nobody has all the answers. So when you don't have the answer, you have to thoughtfully say, I don't know. I don't think I've ever funded anyone who has not, over the course of my having a set of conversations about their business, said, I don't know at some point. In part because my job is to keep asking until we get to the part where you say, oh, I don't know about that. I don't know about that. Go, okay, great. Now you don't know. What do you think? Right? Turns out that question is the most telling one. Okay, you don't know the answer, but what do you think is the answer? Not because it's like you know the answer, right? You've already admitted it, but because that reveals a ton of assumptions about the marketplace, the ecosystem, how you're building your business, how you're thinking about what you're going to do next, how you think about where the market's going, all these things. And if I can have that conversation with you and feel confident that you've gathered a bunch of data, you're being thoughtful about it, you're solving a very big problem, you're onto something that I think is unique and valuable, or whatever, then I might give you money, right? That, and here I have this ridiculous test, but I think it really is the test, which is you know when you go to bed, you lie down in bed, even if you're as sleep deprived as I am, there's still some amount of time between when you close your eyes and when you fall asleep. And you inevitably think about something, right? Maybe think about your kids or your grades or Bernie Sanders or whatever. You think about something. If I go to bed having been pitched on a business and I'm thinking about your business, that's a pretty good sign. If I wake up thinking about your business, then I might actually fund you. If I go to bed thinking about my kids or Bernie or whatever, I'm not going to wake up the next day caring at all, right? So that's a high bar. We're all busy people. We have lots of things we could worry about. If your business is, if you are that engaging and exciting, and your business is that engaging and exciting, that when I go to bed, the thing is like, oh my God, what if we sold a bunch more quilting things? Which I funded that company. That would be amazing, you know? Like, oh my God, if we could get small businesses to have better payroll, what a better universe it would be. Yeah, sorry, one sec. Yeah.
You mentioned that you're receiving thousands of executive summaries from startups, and I imagine that in the analytics field. Have you noticed some trends lately about things that have been happening in that particular field compared to like 2 years ago?
Yeah, I think it's just a volume problem, right? Which is, so there, it's twofold, right? One is that everybody's figured out that analytics matter, right? So that has two impacts. One, it means that lots more people are trying to solve these problems. They're trying to come in and take data and create value from that data. And so there'll be more companies that are addressing these problems. And one of the things that happens, this is actually super interesting, right? If you're in the flow of information about lots and lots of companies, then you get to notice something really curious, which you would think would not happen, right? I had this once where I went into a meeting and I came out of the, and first pitch was super interesting, and I came out of the pitch. Right after I went in the meeting, my partner went into a pitch and he came out of that pitch. And we met in the kitchen and he said, oh my God, I just had a pitch. It was really compelling. I hadn't thought about this. Blah, 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 blah. And he described the pitch I had just received with 100% perfection. Now, you would say, like, how is that even possible, right? Why is that just a coincidence? Now, that one was a particular coincidence because they were back-to-back, but it happens every year all the time. Why does it happen every year all the time? Because there are a bunch of things that are happening that all of us as smart people notice, right? We notice what's happening in Facebook. We see that Instagram is taking over our lives. We understand that Fitbit is on everybody's wrist. We You know, we have seen someone flying a drone and it's awesome. We have tried Google Glass and gone that stupid, whatever. We've done all these things. And so someone is going to come to the same conclusion you are about the opportunity that that creates. And so what I'm seeing is that, where people go, oh, wait a second, there's an infinite amount of data here in this, in a particular context, and we could build something amazing, right? So the history of Uber is exactly this, right? At the end of the day, my partners and I had come to the conclusion that the power of this device ultimately wasn't that it was like some great little computer in your pocket, although that's awesome. It was like, well, what's different? Like, what's the one thing that's different about this from, you know, from your computer that's sitting on your desk? It's location aware, right? It know, it's with you, you know, it knows where you are, it knows what you're doing. So we kept saying, like, okay, what's the thing that's gonna be that business? And I looked at Foursquare and Gowalla, and they were like, oh, explicitly checking in, and Facebook, and I was like, I don't see it. Didn't do those deals. Like, what is it? What is it? What is it? Then Uber comes in. Travis Kalanick, great entrepreneur. I actually backed his last company. Came and said, I got this new thing. It's this thing Uber. We got, you know, limos, and you can call them. And it's like, oh, man, that's kind of interesting. It was growing quickly. My partners and I sat around. We said, okay, how big of the market? How big is there a market for limos, for black cars? It's kind of this big in San Francisco, maybe New York, maybe London. Is that big enough? And we ultimately decide, it's not a big enough market. So we say no. It was the location awareness company that we'd been looking for. We just missed it. It turned out that the way you turn the value of your location, your location into value was Uber. And meanwhile, by the way, the reason that it wasn't a big enough market in our minds is because it wasn't. But Lyft figured out the big enough market. And meanwhile, there was another one called Sidecar, which we also turned down, and there was another one that came. They all figured out that this thing in your pocket could allow you to share rides in some capacity or other, and they all converged on, well, we better figure out how to take out the taxi market because it's the big market. And they were right. It's a huge business. It's an awesome business. It's going to be the best deal of the decade. And Lyft might be the second best deal of the decade, which is even more unusual. So it is this interesting thing where, on the one hand, people understanding that analytics are creating value means that there are going to be a lot more people trying to create that value, but it also means there are going to be a lot more companies that are trying to do those things with the data, right? I think that's good in general, but it creates a lot of competition and challenge. Yeah.
First of all, thanks for coming in. I think this is really interesting. My question is, how do you feel about your role in Adam Grant's book, and more specifically, how do you feel that being a giver has contributed to your success?
Well, thank you for asking. So those of you who have not yet read Adam. So Adam Grant, Professor Wharton, wrote a book called Give and Take. And his thesis is that there are givers and there are takers and there are matchers in the business world. And the givers are people who help others, and the takers are the ones who are just extracting value. And matchers are like, I'll tell you what, you do this for me, I'll help you out, it'll all be good. And Adam did a bunch of work, and he basically says that the givers are both the most successful people and the least successful. Like, if you just give willy-nilly, oh, I'll help you, whoever you are, then the takers will eat you alive. Like, oh, good, we got one. But if you say, look, as a general matter, I'm going to try and help you because I think you're smart and doing valuable stuff and thoughtful stuff, and then you go do the same for others and you're create value, whatever, that value will come back around to you over some period of time. That is the theory. And Adam, and luckily for me, Adam talked to me about a set of circumstances that ended up in the first chapter of his book as a giver. Like, so what do you need? I'm here for you. My favorite line in the book, although I don't actually remember the whole line, but I was flying somewhere. I had the book, and I was with my son, my oldest son, And I pointed, I said to him, check out this sentence, hand him the book, and the sentence read something like, Abraham Lincoln, like Hornik. I was like, check that out. And my son literally threw the book. He just like, this is such crap. So anyway. So one of the things that's interesting about that is that when you are in a book where they say you're a giver, then all sorts of takers reach out to you to ask for things. It's like, and they don't know that they're takers. It's like, oh my God, I read the book and I was so impressed with the way you hold yourself out and the way you've done business and whatever else. And so I'm wondering if you could introduce me to blah, blah, blah. I was like, that's not how it works. That's not sort of thing. I do think that ultimately, if you think about your job and your career and your life as taking kind of 5 years or something, then you can be a taker all you want. Like, because you'll get away with it, and people won't come back around, and they won't take it out on you. It takes a while before the repercussions of being an asshole kick in. But if you think ultimately that your career is going to last for, you know, a number of decades, then it turns out being helpful to people as a general matter is valuable. And not because you're trying to create value, not because you're trying to extract value, but just because people ultimately then want you to be successful. They like would feel better if you're successful because you've helped them be successful. And that kind of, I can't point to it. People are like, oh yeah, says who? I wrote an article, the reason I ended up in this book is that I wrote an article for Wired and it was entitled, Nice Guys Finish First, Eventually. And my theory was exactly this, which is like, if you're a good guy and you're helping people, that eventually they'll help you out. And then there was a whole comment section where people told me I was an idiot. Like, oh, who says, and you have no evidence, you're a moron, and you know, like, where can I find you so I can take stuff from you? And but I just think in the end, so this question of like, you know, how many deals did I have to do? How many deals did I have to try to do in order to get a couple a year or whatever? And the answer is that I only had to do about as many as I wanted to do, because the first thing I do, as Bob knows, is like, when I want to do a deal, I give you the list of everybody I've ever worked with and say, call them. Like, and I don't care who you call any of them, because they'll say like, oh yeah, David's a good guy. Like he genuinely believes that his job, and I do genuinely believe that my job is to try and make the entrepreneurs with whom I work successful. Not to make myself successful, not to, you know, be in a magazine or whatever, but to try and make these companies work and try and make the people who found them, you know, rock stars and all that stuff. And I think that's right, but I don't have any proof of it. And if you're Larry Ellison, you go, ha, that's stupid. Yeah.
So speaking of where analytics is going, people talk a lot about the internet of things. So I just want what your opinion is, given the backdrop of, say, Google Nest failing, well, not failing, but not really doing much.
Well, if you are the firm that takes all the data, then you will win. I give you that, and there's a reason Google bought Nest and then bought Dropcam. And before that, a buddy of mine is the guy who runs Google X, which is now X, and he was trying to figure out how do you build homes? Because he's like, oh, let's just build homes, then I can build the infrastructure, and then I know what's happening in the house, right? But now you have Ring, which is the Aware doorbell, and you have locks, you know, the August lock that you can unlock with your phone and all these things, right? And so there's a bunch of data that you're collecting up about the home experience. And if you could be the aggregator of that information, you could create a bunch of interesting value, right? The Nest is, that's just such a simple but good in some ways example of that, which is, they just said, if we know what you're doing in your house, we can lower the temperature when you're sleeping, raise it when you come out, and it's all good, right? Then you'll save money, but you won't have a worse experience. Here's a great example of the fact that data in and of itself has to, you need data integrity in order to create value. Our nest was not working. It was completely broken. And my wife was like, why did you put this stupid nest in? It doesn't work. It's always getting hot or cold. It's ridiculous. And I said, this is a machine. It's not, I have this conversation with my wife a lot. Like, it's just data. Like, it's not like, oh, it's not out to get you, and it's not a bad actor. So there's some issue with the algorithm, but that's not, but if that's solved, it will do exactly what it's supposed to do. And I was trying to figure out, like, why is the algorithm not working? Because it's making me look bad. And then I found out the answer, which is my son's friend Shelby, when she came into the house, went boop every time. She fucked with my nest every time because she thought it was funny. And then I'd have to go, what? You know, and I have to. So the data integrity problem was Shelby, not the data itself. But if the data was pure, then my wife would have been like, this nest is great, you know? So I have seen a number of companies that are trying to create hubs that will gather up unify those experiences, unify the smart lights and the smart locks and whatever else, and therefore allow you to have a better experience, but more importantly, then have all that data which they then can create value from. That makes perfect sense, but who's going to do that, right? Comcast is trying to do it. Your electric company is going to try and do it. Will anyone do it? If they do, it is a better experience, right? But do we really need a smart refrigerator? Does anyone really need it to say, like, by the way, you're almost out of milk? No crap, I just had cereal. I know that I'm out of milk. So what is the real value? So Internet of Things, the real value, I think, is in your car. It's like there is an immense amount of data that tells you about how you behave and what, right? I have an app that is a thing called Mile IQ. Mile IQ is the simplest concept ever, meaningless to you in New York, but it is a very simple concept, which is it tracks where I drive on a map, and then when I'm done with those drives, I say, this was a personal drive, this was my commute, or this was a business drive to the city that is unreimbursed. And at the end of the year, it gives me a report that says, here are all of the drives you've taken that were unreimbursed. You can expense $3,600 worth of unreimbursed miles or whatever. Super simple, complete, obvious value. Getting better by the second. It knows what my commute is, right? Because I keep saying, no, that's my commute. No, that's my commute. Eventually it goes, oh, that's his commute. Now I don't even have to check that, right? Now it knows, and it just gives me money. My phone goes, here's money, because I've gathered data. How good is that? And by the way, then it charges you $90 or something to give you $4,000. You go, no problem. And then next year it says it's $200, and you go, no problem, right? And it's $3,000, and you go, really? Yeah. Oh, Slack. Slack is either the greatest thing that's ever hit enterprises or not. Do people know what Slack is? Slack's basically like this enterprise messaging thing. Think of Facebook Messenger, but for business, that allows you to use certain hashtags. It can integrate with your data services, so if you're running a development team, you can communicate with your team, and you can save information, and you can search it, and whatever else. There is not a great solution at the moment for communicating across teams. I think it is an interesting solution, and it has grown quickly. I think one of two things will happen. It will continue to do that and dominate the enterprise messaging space and be an extraordinarily valuable company. Or other people will build things like it, and Facebook will figure out how to make Messenger an enterprise thing. And if you were Box or Dropbox, you'd wake up and go, like, why is Slack owning this? That's stupid, and you'd build it in. And so this is the problem with the venture business. It's super easy in retrospect, and super hard in, you know, looking forward. I guess we'll see. But I didn't invest. Did not invest. Didn't have the opportunity early on, and then the price got insane. So, yes, and then I'll be back.
So, in the spirit of analytics and, like, looking forward not 3 to 5 years, but 20 to 30 years.
Yes.
Data and machine learning should be constrained, like you fall in the Terminator or do you consider that unbound is the best policy?
Yeah, this is a religious question, so I'm happy to acknowledge it as such. No, I'm actually an unbound data person. The conversation I've had around this for years is around privacy, right? For the longest time, there were these conversations about privacy and private data and what data should we keep private and all this stuff. And people thought because I was a civil libertarian and a lefty and all this stuff that I would be, you got to keep data private or whatever. And the reality is that to my mind, they 100% misunderstood privacy, right? To my mind, the question is not, is your information kept private? To my mind, the question is, do you have control over your information to determine if it's private or not private? And in particular, because I want all of my information to be consumed by everything I touch, because I want it to understand me and create a better experience for me. You guys, almost none of you ever experienced Amazon before it knew anything about you, but it was pretty crappy. It was like, oh, it was just like going to any other store. Now you get to go to Amazon, it knows who you are, and it knows what you want to buy. And when you buy something, it also knows that you should, oh, by the way, that cord isn't included. How many times have you bought the thing and you get it home, and they're like, oh crap, it doesn't have the cord. Amazon knows that. They're not going to let that happen to you. How good is the world where that doesn't happen to you? You get, oh, it goes, oh, buy the cord, dummy. Thanks, I'd love the cord. So, and by the way, you need diapers because you're out. Thanks, I'd love that. So this is a microcosm of everything else, you know, which is like, I think that the more data that we are able to consume and bring to bear to create value, the more value that will be created. I'm sure there are nefarious individuals who are busy trying to figure out how to do terrible things with that data. I am a complete moron in this regard, but I am an incredible optimist, and I believe that the world is full of a much larger number of smart, thoughtful analytics geniuses than evil scumbags, and therefore they will win. So if there are a bunch of people trying to figure out how to do evil things a la Terminator, that's cool because we got the rest of the geniuses going, uh-uh, I got this, just give me all your data, and you know what we'll be able to do with that data? Find the evil geniuses and crush them. But I may be wrong.
So what do you think about data analytics and data sharing in the enterprise space, where looks to me most enterprises, their data is still kind of separated from each other, and it's kind of hard to get compared to consumer data. So
this is inter-company data as opposed to intra-company data. Yeah, it's getting better because it turns out that there are very few companies that are able to do their business without touching other companies, right? And this is particularly clear because everything's moving to the cloud, right? So you can't have a corporation that doesn't have a bunch of your information and data sitting out in the cloud. And so even if you keep it siloed in these different services, Salesforce has this and Amazon Web Service has this, whatever, it's still that data's already out there. And then what we're learning is that if you take that data and you give access to it more broadly in the cloud, then you can create value. So when I funded this company, PayCycle, everybody's like, no one's going to put their employees' information in the cloud, right? They're not going to give you social security numbers and put it out there. They're not going to do these things. Of course they are. Like, why? Because it's easy. Because if you're a small business owner and it's 2 a.m. and you want to pay payroll, you're psyched that it's all in the cloud and you go click, 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 and it's paid. And if you didn't put it in the cloud, then you'd have to call somebody the next morning and you're late on payroll. And so it turns out that enterprises are learning that across everything. So when they're sourcing things to try and figure out how to build something, or they want competition among their suppliers, or, you know, so you take PayCycle, now it's bill.com. You manage your accounts payable and receivable using an online service and you pay them electronically. Suddenly you can say to your suppliers, hey, I already sent you the money, get me my stuff. You can say to others who owe you, hey, if you pay me sooner, I'll give you 2% off. You can do all these things that are beneficial to each of the businesses that you couldn't do if you're siloed and sending a paper check, right? And so I just think that will happen across everything. And then people will get to make business decisions, say like, this information is my value, I cannot give it to you, but the rest of the stuff is just, is generic, and we'll have shared value across it. Last question, or have we run out? Yes. I guess the short answer is no. there are lots of point solutions that are trying to solve problem, you know, energy and water problems in small ways, and those things will create value, but in the end, our bigger problem is not just water, but shifting populations. You look at China with massive populations shifting to cities. We have the same thing in the US, and so you have have overpopulation, it has all sorts of repercussions and all of those things. I have to say, like, in the end, as a venture capitalist, I think that every challenge is an opportunity, right? Because when you're pitching me or anyone else, the first thing you have to do is say, there is a problem, and here is the problem. And now here's how other people have tried to solve it, they failed, this is the answer, right? So has anyone come up with any answer to the we have no water and that's a huge problem? No. Does that mean we'll have, like in Israel, desalination? Maybe. Does it mean that people will move somewhere else where they should be living? Maybe, you know, whatever. But I look at all of this stuff as opportunity, and I'm not a doomsayer. I'm sure that's shocking to all of you at this point. So stay tuned. Someone's going to come to me with the answer.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, David.
Thank you.